In 1948, our First Baptist Church had an argument over whether or not they should fire the pastor who was accused of a scandalous sin. Half the congregation felt that he was innocent. The other half felt that, no, he really was guilty of this thing. And so they had a vote, and the vote prevailed in favor of the pastor, and so he was going to stay. However, the half of the people who were against him staying were not going to tolerate that, so they left the First Baptist Church, and they founded another church here in town called Calvary Baptist Church. Some of you were members of Calvary Baptist Church. So then we had these two churches that, you know, just were kind of struggling with one pastor each. I came to the First Baptist Church in 1982. In 1986, the Calvary Baptist Church was without a pastor, and so their deacons approached our deacons and said, maybe we should pray about reuniting. So for 3 months, the two deacon boards from the two churches met together on Saturday mornings to pray, and I was in those prayer meetings. We prayed every Saturday morning for 3 months about possibly reuniting as one church again. And at the end of 3 months, they took a vote, and it was unanimous that they both deacon boards said, yes, we should reunite. So they had a fourfold plan. Each deacon board would go back to their church and first of all tell them about these prior 3 months of prayer with the deacon board from the other church. Second, let them know that as a result of the prayers, the deacons were recommending that we reunite. Third step was to give the congregation 3 months of its own to pray about this and talk about it. And then the fourth step, at the end of the following 3 months, each church would vote on possibly merging together. Well, at the Calvary Baptist Church side, everybody was excited and for it, but on the First Baptist side, we had especially four members who were determined to overthrow this. And so they found some other members who hadn't really been to worship services in years and years, but were still members, and therefore they could still vote, and therefore they were going to bring them to the vote meeting at the end of the 3 months. It had to be by a two-thirds majority to pass. These four disgruntled members from our church sued our leadership board and me in Tulare County Superior Court 2 times. For me to be able to talk to these four members of my own church, I had to give the message to our lawyer, who would give the message to their lawyer, who would give the message to the church members. Boy, how about that? Those four people also wrote a letter to the Dinuba Sentinel newspaper complaining that the merger was a terrible idea, Pastor Tom was stealing the church from us, and it will never work. Even if it does go through, the church won't grow as a result. It's a bad idea. And that letter was printed on page 1 of the Dinuba Sentinel, front page. On Sunday mornings during those 3 weeks, 3 months, we would have worship services, and then I'd get up to preach, you know, and I'd walk up, and as soon as I got behind the pulpit, I noticed those four people stand up, walk out of the pews, and leave. They were, you know, protesting my being in the pulpit. That really hurt. All these things hurt me very, very deeply. During those 3 months, I never said to the congregation, be sure to vote for the merger. It's the right thing to do. Instead, I took the position, I believe that God will work through the voice of our members. And whatever that vote comes out, I will take that as God's will. And if the vote says that we should not merge the two congregations, I'll accept that as God's will, and we'll just go on as two separate churches again. Well, in the Calvary Baptist Church, the vote was unanimous to do it. And in the First Baptist Church, we did get more than a two-thirds majority, and the at that point, the disgruntled members left the church and went into some other churches. Well, soon after that, I would run into people who would say to me, "This is the first church I've ever heard of that came together with another church. I've heard a lot about churches splitting, but this is the first one that has done the opposite of splitting and come together." We immediately hired a full-time youth pastor, and that was a terrific blessing. A couple of years later, we hired a half-time children's pastor, and that position became full-time a few years later. And a few years after that, we hired a half-time associate pastor, and that position became eventually full-time. So, you know, like right now, we have four full-time pastors. So God really did bless the union of the two members. In 1996, 10 years after the merger vote was taken, we moved into this facility right here. It was valued at $3 million. We paid $2 million because we got $1 million worth of free labor out of our own church members in building this church. We borrowed only $250,000 for our mortgage when we moved in, and we paid the mortgage off in 5 years without any fundraiser, without ever asking for a penny. The land that our former church rested on was 1/4 acre. Here we have 5.5 acres. So our land here is more than 20 times larger than the old place. So God did bless the merger of the two churches. And because of that conflict, 1986 was the worst year of my ministry. But it was also maybe the best year of my ministry. The first half of 1986 was a total nightmare for me. The second half of 1986 was a total blessing. And fortunately, other than 1986, our First Baptist Church has enjoyed very nice unity. Now, all this talk about the scandal of a church division isn't to say that you, as church members, may not agree with me. I have always understood that I'm accountable to you. Our real authority is not the pastor, it's the Word of God. And if I say or do something contrary to Scripture, I should be corrected. I have never tried to be the dictator of this church, and our church constitution gives me no such right. I know that I'm the under-shepherd, with Jesus being the chief shepherd. You are always free to vote against any ideas I may have, and I will never rebuke you for doing that or even feel offended if you do that. We have a congregational form of government, and that means that I, as the pastor, don't get to call the shots. In the business meetings, I have one vote because I'm one member of the church, and that's all the clout I can give. I obviously, as the pastor, I get to recommend things and sometimes urge, you know, to go one way or another. But our deacon board has authority over me, and so does our entire congregation. Now, in the 15th chapter of Acts, Paul and Barnabas broke up as a missionary team, and they went their separate ways. You could look at that as a church division, but God actually blessed both of their missionary endeavors after each man teamed up with someone else. Sometimes those things just happen, and it's not the end of the world or the end of the church. But still, sometimes Christians can divide over the dumbest things. I read in a book a story of two churches. They were little churches in the same town. They were both kind of struggling. And they were talking about coming together as one unified church, and they were really warming up to the idea. Now, both of these churches practiced the liturgy, and in the liturgy, in their worship services, they would recite the Lord's Prayer. One church, when they got to this certain point in the Lord's Prayer, would say, "Forgive us our trespasses." The other church would say, "Forgive us our debts." So now they're talking about unifying as one new church, and so they're saying to each other, "Well, are we going to say trespasses or debts?" And neither side was going to budge, and so they decided, well, then we just won't merge as one church. We'll just stay two separate churches. And the newspaper, when they were reporting the story of this, concluded the article by saying, "So one church went back to its trespasses while the other returned to its debts." Well, yeah, sometimes churches can divide over little things. Here's Leadership Journal, and it says, "If five pastors are sitting at a table, in most cases, all five of them can tell the story of a major conflict in their church, and one of them can describe a battle that's raging right now. About 4 in 10 pastors told us they had left a pastoral position due to conflict." Wow. Well, our passage today is in Philippians 4:1-3. And it tells about a division in the Philippian church. We find this in verse 2. "I plead with Euodia and I plead with Syntyche to agree with each other in the Lord." These were two women in the Philippian church. They had a disagreement. We don't know what it was, but obviously one woman was saying, "I think the church should do such and such." And the other, Syntyche, was saying, no, not that. We should do something else. And probably the church members in Philippi were taking sides. Now, in this passage, verses 1 to 3, I can find 5 reasons that division in a church is a scandal. And I'm going to walk you through and point out these 5 reasons. Here's number 1. Division in the church contradicts its emphasis on Christ. In verse 1, we read, "Stand firm in the Lord." Here's an issue of Moody magazine, and in it, it tells a story about Pastor Don Baker. And have we got his photo? There he is, yeah. Okay, let me read this story to you out of Moody magazine. "I stood on the jungle path confronted by a Papuan pygmy," writes Don Baker. "As a member of the armed forces assigned to New Guinea, Baker unexpectedly found himself face to face with the terrifying headhunters. Alone and vulnerable, he attempted to communicate with these people who blocked his path. Baker knew that missionaries had been serving in that area. His only hope was that they had made an impact. His life depended on it. I tried a familiar dialect," Baker said. "Then I reinforced the words with some crude attempts at sign language, but the pygmy only stared pensively at me. He seemed more like a wild animal than a human being. Then I hit upon the word that worked like open sesame. I said, 'Christos? Christos?' His eyes lit up at that name, and he put both his palms together, prayer fashion. Then he knelt and with a stick drew a picture of the cross in the sand. To my relief, the person I feared and had judged subhuman was not my enemy at all, but turned out to be my brother in Christ." Christos, the word for Christ. So that's where our unity comes from. Now, we all know that mountain climbers, when they go up the mountain, they tie themselves together with a rope. And this is so that if one mountain climber kind of slips and stumbles, the others can still hold him up while he regains his footing. Well, in the church, I think we're a lot like mountain climbers. If one person slips and falls, the others can, you know, hold him up until he regains his footing. We're all tied together with a rope, and the rope that ties us together is Jesus Christ. In John 12:32, Jesus said, But when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all men to myself. Since Jesus draws you to himself and me to himself, he draws you and me close to each other. And that means we can live in unity. And so it is that division in the church contradicts our emphasis on Christ. Instead of being at each other's throats, we should obey the command here in verse 1, stand firm in the Lord. Now for the second lesson. Division in the church contradicts its emphasis on love. You've probably heard of the Greek word agape. It's found many times in the New Testament. It describes the highest kind of love. It's consistently used of God's love. And there are other words for love, but this is the highest one. Well, that Greek word agape is found twice in verse 1 of our passage, both times in its adjective form. The first time is when Paul says, whom I love, and the second time is when he calls them dear friends. Both of those are agape in adjective form. Over in John 13, 34 and 5, Jesus said, a new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. Nelson Grover was a member of our church. He's in heaven now. Every time I would see him, he would always say the same two things to me. He would say, I love you, Pastor Tom, and I'm praying for you. And boy, that always touched my heart, his love. According to Patrick Morley, the height of our love for God will never exceed the depth of our love for one another. Discipleship Journal quotes a man named Jeff Gorsuch, who says, the question to ask at the end of life's race is not so much what have I accomplished, but whom have I loved and how courageously? Many Christians are different from me, but I must love them all. Some are grouchy, but I must love them. Sometimes I'm grouchy. Some are unwilling to grow spiritually, but I must love them. Some complain about me, but I must love them. In 1986, some of my church members tried to force me out as their pastor, but God wanted me to love them, and I tried to do that with his help. Here's Billy Graham's magazine, Decision Magazine, and they put in here a little poem written by Helen Stalkup of Conway, Arkansas. Apparently she's one of the readers of the magazine. She sent this in and they published it. Listen to this. I loved my church, except a few my heart seemed to resist. I pled with God for love enough. I even made a list. That very day the Lord began in moments opportune to show me ways to overcome antipathy, and soon I grew quite fond of numbers 1, 2, 3. Then I could say, why, Lord, you helped me love them all. I threw my list away. When you choose to love, love becomes easier to give. Now, when you stop to think about it, there's a difference between a friendly church and a church of friends. A church of friends is one in which, you know, here's the church, and inside you got this group, and they're all friends with each other. The church of friends may not like it at all when a newcomer from the comes in, because he's not one of their friends. But a friendly church, they love it when newcomers come in from the outside. They make it easy for them to feel like they belong here and like they're one of us and so forth. And really, I know, I mean, this isn't a perfect church, but this is very strongly a friendly church. How do I know that? Because people have told me for years. I've heard this so many times where people come to our church and a couple of months later or whatever, they say to me, "Oh boy, as soon as I came to your church, people just surrounded me and spoke to me and loved me and welcomed me and made me feel so good. And I came back the next week and the same thing happened and I met other people," so forth. So I'm saying to you, dear people, thank you very much for being a friendly church and not just a church of friends. But still, the friendly church is a loving church, and that safeguards us from division. But still, we must be careful to maintain our emphasis on love and to practice love. And now for the third lesson in this passage. Division in the church contradicts its emphasis on the gospel. Now, these same two women, Euodia and Syntyche, who were arguing, Paul says of them, "They have contended at my side in the cause of the gospel." There it is, the gospel. You know what our gospel is. It's the message that God sent his one and only Son, Jesus, to this earth to become the substitute for sinners on the cross, to die for sinners and pay the penalty for their sins by shedding his own blood and giving his own life. And God raised Jesus from the dead. He's alive forever. And now anyone who puts their trust in Jesus as their personal Savior will receive God's salvation, including forgiveness, membership in God's home, abundant life, and an eternal home in heaven. Now, even when we're preaching that glorious gospel, conflict can occur. Servants of the Lord can clash with one another. Human nature interferes with God's work all too easily. My opinions don't matter. Only the gospel matters. It isn't important that I get my way when in conflict with a brother or sister in Christ, in the church. The only important thing is that the church goes out. The gospel goes out. I'm sure you remember Mahatma Gandhi. He was a religious leader in India, and they refer to him as the father of his country, India. Now, I didn't read his autobiography, but he wrote one, and I read about it, and it said that in his autobiography, he tells this story, that when he was a student, he started reading the Bible, and he was captivated by it, and he was very seriously considering converting to Christianity. So he went to a Christian church on a Sunday morning, and he walked in, and he was planning to ask the pastor after the service, "Tell me, please, the plan of salvation." But he walked into the service and an usher met him right there and kind of held up his hands and said, wait a minute. He said, I think it would just be better if you left here today and just went back and worshiped with your own kind. And Gandhi says in his autobiography, "In India, I was trying to overthrow the caste system. And I come into a church and I learn that the church has its own caste system. So I said to myself, I might as well just remain a Hindu." Wow. And so it is that we can forfeit great blessings in the church if we divide people into groups of those who are welcome and those who are not. That contradicts the gospel. you probably know who the three tenors are. Three famous opera tenors: Jose Carreras, Placido Domingo, and Luciano Pavarotti. Well, here's a piece I photocopied out of a magazine. They were performing in Los Angeles, and the interviewer asked them the question, "Do you men ever compete with each other? Does competition ever come into the thing here?" And Domingo gave this answer: "You have to put all of your concentration into opening your heart to the music. You can't be rivals when you're making music together." Well, we make music together every Sunday, right here in this church. You can't be rivals when you're making music to Jesus together. And we also make another kind of music too, namely the proclamation of the gospel. That is the music that we make here in this world. And we can't be rivals when we're proclaiming the gospel. Division in the church contradicts its emphasis on the gospel. All right, now number four. Division in the church contradicts its emphasis on relationships. Somebody once said, "To live above with saints we love will certainly be glory. To live below with saints we know, well, that's another story." One of my seminary professors was Lewis Smedes. Here's his autobiography. And in this, I'm going to read you a story he tells about his disappointment with his own denomination. It was the Christian Reformed denomination. Listen to this. "It so happened that a small Christian Reformed church struggling to thrive in a small village in the center of North Carolina was intimidated by its neighbors into turning away a family of color from its worship. I was sent south to size up the situation and come back with some recommendations. When I came back, I drafted a statement that declared to the world that our denomination was ready to open its doors and its membership to all people of whatever color. Our regional assembly approved it and sent it on to the General Synod. The General Synod rejected it. Before a vote was taken, the elders of the assembly reminded us young idealists that integration of black people into our church would never work because our doctrines were too deep and rich for them to comprehend. To this insult, they tried to revive a dead notion that both the Bible and tradition support the separation of races in the church as well as in society. And as the coup de grace, they warned us that if we took them into our church, we would eventually end up with them as wives and husbands of our children. God have mercy on the Christian Reformed Church." Now that was years and years ago. I doubt the Christian Reformed denomination is that way. Somebody once told Charles Spurgeon that his preaching was perfect for black people. And Spurgeon replied, "Oh, terrific! Then I know it's also going to be helpful for white people, because after all, I don't preach to people's skins, I preach to their hearts." Now look at verse 3 in our passage. "Yes, and I ask you, loyal yoke fellow, help these women who have contended at my side in the cause of the gospel, along with Clement and the rest of my fellow workers whose names are in the book of life." Now, here we've got four words in this third verse, each of which has the Greek word, the Greek root word, with in it, or together with, implying one person together with another person. And all four of these are in verse 3. We'll look at them one at a time. The first is the word yoke fellow. And it literally means in the Greek, in the yoke, together with someone else. So this gives us a picture of two people working side by side in a yoke like oxen would pull, pulling for the same goal. The question comes up, who was this yoke fellow in the Philippian church Paul is speaking to in verse 3? Well, the Bible doesn't say, we don't know, but it was some unknown member of the church. The second word is the word help. And in Greek, it literally means take hold of together with the other person. This suggests two people taking on a task together such that the second person begins to help the first person. And then the third one is, who have contended at my side. And it literally means, who have been in the athletic contest together with me. So I thought, oh, that's neat. Athletic contest. Here's the Bible talking about athletic contest. Two people together in an athletic contest. So I've got an illustration of that for you here. There it is. My favorite sport, tennis. There's Roger Federer on the left, Stan Wawrinka on the right. They won the gold medal in the 2008 Olympics in doubles. And notice how you can see the ball right in the middle. Looks like Federer's got his racket in front. He's going to hit it, but Stan is, they are perfectly in sync. And boy, that looks so, so attractive to me. This is my idea of teamwork in an athletic contest. And then the fourth word term here in verse 3 is my fellow workers. And that literally means the workers together with me. So the point is, there are no solo acts in the Christian church. Our church and every church is made up of relationships. We're in this together. So division in the church contradicts its emphasis on relationships. And now for the fifth and final warning about division. Division in the church contradicts its emphasis on heaven. At the end of verse 3, Paul writes, regarding these two women who are disagreeing, whose names are in the book of life. The book of life is a book in heaven in which the names of the saved people from all time are recorded. Twice, the book of Revelation tells us that our names were written in the book of life before the world was ever created. You get your name in the book of life not when you become a Christian, but before you're ever created. But when you become a Christian, that's when you realize, okay, I'm now a child of God. Now, I'll tell you a story, true story, about two men in our church. The first man left our church some years ago, a number of years ago. The second man left a number of years ago. The first man stayed in our church. And the first man tells me this story. He was praying one day, and in his prayer, he said to God regarding this second man who was no longer in the church. He said, Lord, I know that when we get to heaven, there's not going to be any awkward feeling between us. And so help me here on earth to mend the broken relationship now. Soon after that, it was the wedding anniversary of the first man and his wife. So they went out to dinner. They get into this restaurant, and then in walks the second man and his wife. And they walk past the first couple, and everybody says, hello. And when the dinner was over, the first man and his wife, who were celebrating their anniversary, they left the restaurant and walked back to their car. He tells me that their car was about a block away. They walked back, and as they're getting into their car, he notices that second man, his car, is right next to theirs. And here he comes, with his wife, the second man. So he gets up there, you know, and they say hello again or something, you know, did you have a nice dinner and so forth. The second man says to the first man, why don't we meet for breakfast on Friday or whatever day? First man says, okay, yes. And they went to breakfast, and the first man tells me that getting together with him, the other guy, for breakfast that day went miles and miles in healing their relationship. Here were two people, two men, who both took a giant step forward in enjoying their heavenly unity. Both of their names are written in the book of life, and in heaven they will be unified. So I thought it was great of them to patch up their personal differences here on earth by getting together as they did. Now we come to the action step. Here's what I'd like you to do as a result of working through this passage with me. Pray that God will keep our church unified. Ephesians 4:3 is good along this line. It says, make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. That verse implies that our spiritual unity is not automatic. Like a good marriage that still must be nurtured, we must do our utmost to keep our spiritual unity. We can start by thanking God for the measure of unity we already have in our church. Follow that up by asking God to show you if you might be a cause somewhere of a division in our church. And then also pray for that God might help you fulfill the role of the yoke fellow in verse 3 of this passage by helping two other people come together who are at odds. You and I don't want to be a scandalous church that divides. So let's be a church that God blesses. Let's be unified in our love for Christ, our love for one another, our commitment to make a difference for Christ, and our sharing of the gospel. Lord, thank you for unifying the church under the blood of Christ. Please unify us, Lord. We are an imperfect church, although there are many blessings that we can name. And help us not to take for granted any unity that we do have. And so may the world look at us and say, they've got it together on relationships. They know how to get along with each other, and I want to be part of that. In Jesus' name we ask, amen.